Well, good morning, friends. We're going to go ahead and get started this morning on this Labor Day weekend. I'm sure we'll have some folks straggling in here in a few minutes. But just want to say welcome to all of you all. I'm so glad that y'all came out to worship with us today. Good morning. Sorry, I'm saying hi to my son as he walked in. But it's good to be together. When y'all come in the door, there are announcement sheets on the tables. There's also an email that goes out with all those announcements on it. I encourage you to read through that. It's got a lot of good information in there. Also, if you'd like to fill out a Connect card this morning, if you're visiting with us, I love when y'all fill those out. You can put those in the boxes over here by the door here, in the box in the back. You can also give financially this morning to support what we do here in those boxes as well, or give online. We have a stream of the service in the cafe and on Facebook, and so you can check it out there too. If you ever need to step out, you can go into the cafe. We've got a lot of fun things planned this morning, so we're just going to jump right into it, and I'll highlight some important announcements as more people start coming in. But Matthew is going to lead us in our call to worship, and so as you're able, let's all stand together, and we will say this together.
Would you join me? O Lord, let my soul rise up to meet you. As the day rises to meet the sun, glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly through the trees. When I look down from a lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. That God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, 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 how great thou art.
Amen. Amen.
And please join me in this confession. We know that nothing is able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Let us in freedom confess the wrong that we have done. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Well, what we're going to do now is we're going to spend a few minutes just talking with one another. What we call this our time of gratitude and lament. We just turn to a few people around you, maybe two, three, four, five people. Make sure you introduce yourself. And also, if you have something you're grateful for, you can share that. Or if you have a lament, something that's not going so well, something that's way in heaven in your heart, you can share that too. But let's do that now, and I'll call you back together in just a few minutes. Thank you. All right, if y'all want to take maybe like 30 seconds to a minute, start wrapping up, make sure everybody's had a chance to share. I'll call you back in just a moment. So we're going to continue worshiping God through singing together. I've selected some songs from back in the late 90s, early 2000s. So, you know, the 90s are coming back in style, and so, you know, we're bringing it back in our worship songs. But I chose these songs for a reason. Lately, Laura and I both have had to spend a lot of time in our son's bedroom as he's trying to fall asleep because he needs a little extra support right now. And he always wants us to sing to him. And so all the songs that come to my mind are the ones I sang back when I was in youth group because those are the ones that are like implanted in my brain. And so these songs we're going to sing are songs I've been singing to Kai at night before bedtime. And it's very interesting because as they have brought peace to his mind and his body and his spirit, they also have brought a lot of peace to my mind and body and spirit. As I've been singing them to him, it's really been a moment of worship for me, and it's been really awesome for me and such an important time for me during the day. And so these are songs just about finding God and longing for Jesus, longing for God in our lives. And so I'm going to ask y'all to stand as you're able, and we're going to sing together.
Lord, I want more of you. Living water rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. Living breath of life, come and fill me up. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Thirsty for more of you. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Touch you. We lift our voice. voices higher and higher and higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher and higher to you. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty. Oh, Jesus, we are thirsty for more of you. We are hungry, we are hungry, we are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh, Jesus, we are thirsty for more of you. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. To know you more. Oh.
Transition to a time of prayer. So let's continue in that spirit of worship, that spirit of prayer. If anybody would like to come kneel at the altar with me, you're welcome to come kneel here if you like to pray in that way, if you'd like to stand, if you'd like to walk around, whatever you want to do, whatever works for you, feel free to do it. But I'm going to move down here to the altar, and then we'll continue on in a spirit of prayer. God is here among us, moving around this space, moving in our hearts and our bodies and our minds. bringing comfort and peace, conviction, love, confidence. The Spirit is here bringing what it is that we need this morning. I know for some of us, this day has maybe not started as we hoped it would. Maybe we're already feeling stressed and overwhelmed through a morning of chaos and activity. Maybe this morning your kids aren't cooperating like you hoped they would. And maybe for you kids, your parents aren't cooperating the way you hoped they would. But we're here, and God, I just pray that no matter what we're facing, no matter what we're bringing with us this morning, that your Spirit would consume us, wrap around us, enter into our minds and our bodies, help us to relax, to settle in, and hear from you today. God, we need you every step of the way. And God, I pray that we could invite you in, that we would have the courage and the openness to invite you to walk with us every step of the way. And God, thank you that you want to be with us. No matter where we are in our life, no matter what path we go down, that you walk with us and you stick beside us. Lord, we know you don't force yourself upon us, but we know, Lord, that you're there waiting for us to turn to you. So my hope is that we can turn to you this morning. Maybe we're already facing you and we're already there, but we need to turn even closer. We need to move even closer to you this morning. Maybe some of us aren't really focused on you at all, and we're doing our own thing. And help us to turn back, Lord. And I imagine there's people maybe here who've never felt like they've been close to you. And I pray that you would just be there and help them to feel your loving touch and presence this morning. God, we need you so much. And we are here this morning in this space crying out to you. We are hungry for you. We are thirsty for you. As the deer, Lord, pants for the streams of water, so our souls long for you. We ask, where can we go? Where can we go to meet with you? And we thank you. We thank you for Jesus and the gift of the Spirit that tells us we don't have to go anywhere, that you're right there with us, that you are so close to us. You are all around us, moving and working. And so, God, we need you. We pray you would be close today. And, God, we pray we could receive whatever it is we need this morning. It may not be exactly what we want, but Lord, we pray that we would receive what we need. We pray our desires and our longings would be more in line with what yours are, until we could borrow your eyes and ears to see and to hear and to borrow all the things, Lord, about you so that we can experience this world in the way you do, with hearts full of love for all things. We now join together and pray this prayer that Jesus taught us, his disciples, to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Was good to be together today. Glad y'all came out to worship with us on this Labor Day weekend. And I hope you feel God's presence here, because God is here. God is here among us. I want to share just a couple of quick announcements with you all this morning. I don't have my announcement sheet, but hopefully I can remember. Does anyone have one I can look at? Is that possible? Thank you, Donna. So a few things I want to remind you of is that the office is going to be closed tomorrow. The church is going to be closed tomorrow. And so we're not going to be having any of our Monday stuff. That includes our meal at the gathering and also the worship service on Monday night. We always take off just two or three Mondays a year to give our volunteers, because it's basically volunteer run, and we know that burnout is a thing. You know, if you just keep giving and giving and giving and you don't take a break, then it's hard to keep doing it. And so we want to make sure we give our volunteers a break and be able to take a night off. And so Labor Day worked the best for us this year, and so that's what we're doing. But we'll be back on our normal schedule next week. And so the office will open back up as well on Tuesday. Also, I've talked about the elevator the last couple of weeks, but I just want to give you all an update. You know, we put out a goal for you all, our church, to try to raise $10,000 among our people, because we ended up getting $45,000 through some of our connections with the United Methodist Church, which has been awesome. I mean, you can read more about that in your bulletin, but y'all far exceeded our $10,000 goal. We raised over $16,000 as a church, which is great. So thank you all so much for your generosity, and thank you for the ways that God has been moving here and providing. We still have a remaining cost of about $30,000, and we've always planned to be able to use some of our reserves to pay for that, and we can. But if you were wanting to give to this project, every little bit that's given helps that money to be able to use for something else. And so if you still would like to give, we still have a need. And so, feel free to. The elevator should be up and running fairly soon, which we're really excited about. And so we'll keep you posted on that. And I know a lot of our Monday folks in particular are going to be very excited, because every week we have our meal downstairs, and everybody will be able to be together now. And we won't have to separate our groups by those who can go downstairs and who can't. And so that's going to be really cool. Also, it looks like the seasoned embracers are having a lunch after church. Is this happening today? I think so. Or no, is that next week? Or is that today? Well, I think September 8th is when it happens, but that's not today, though it says today. Regardless, it's okay. And so that's next week, so I encourage y'all to look at that if you are generally 55 plus, but they don't, you know, they're not going to leave anybody out who wants to hang out with them. But this is a group of folks who are more seasoned in life, is how they like to talk about themselves, which I love. Also, Common Good has a pretty huge need for mentors for their after-school program. It starts on Tuesday. So if you have an afternoon free during the week, then it would be a great opportunity for you all. There's information in there on how to get involved with Common Good. But it's our after-school program that Common Good runs in our basement that's from kindergarten through 12th grade. So if you like to hang out with young people and think that could be something you could do, then this is a wonderful opportunity. And so there's information in the bulletin about that. And I'll also just alert you, we're going to start putting on the backside some important dates that are coming up, so I encourage y'all to look through those. And also, we're going to start including a financial update in there each week, so y'all can kind of see where we're at with our finances throughout the month, just so y'all can be updated on that. And if you have any questions about any of that, please let us know. All right? Sound good? All right, cool. So this morning we're doing something a little bit different than normal. I'm not going to share a sermon this morning, and instead we're going to hear from you all. Every time we do this, I always wonder, will anybody say anything? And you always do. So you need to do it this week, all right? You need to live up to it. We got a little smaller crowd today. But we've been in this series in the book of Acts for quite a few weeks now. We started back even before, around the time of Pentecost, right after Easter. And we've been going through the book of Acts, and we've made it through about 17, 18 chapters, something like that. And so we wanted to take a moment to pause in our series just to kind of look at where we've come from and give you all a chance to share some of your insights, some of your thoughts, some of your questions, things you're wondering about, things that maybe God is doing in your heart through this series. I've heard through different conversations with you all that you've been thinking a lot and really asking some really good questions and really trying to let this penetrate your heart and your life. And so I came up with an overview of where we've come. And so hopefully each of you have one of these. If you do not, then I have extras right here. And if you would like one, please raise your hand and we will give you one. Does anybody need one? Yes, we have a couple. Laura, you want to come down and grab it? That would be great. It is in the email. You know, I communicate in a variety of ways with you all. So I wanted to make sure you had it. Yes. You need two? Perfect. Now, you may look at it and think, that's a lot of information, but it's really just most of the sermons are summarized in about one sentence, and I try to help you refresh your memory of where we've come from. And so I want y'all to take a moment. I'm going to kind of read through them, and then what we're going to do after that is Dustin's going to come up here, and he'll have another microphone, and we're just going to give y'all an opportunity to raise your hand if you would like to say something and share kind of a way God has been working in your heart. On the back, there are some reflection questions that can guide you. How has God spoken to you during this Acts series? What dreams has God placed on your heart? I had a few conversations with some of you who have some pretty big dreams about what our church might be able to do differently after reading through Acts. What lingering questions or wonderings do you have? What is like shimmered, stuck out, stayed with you as we've gone through this series? And so I'm just going to read through this, and y'all can follow along. We can pretend like you're back in school if you're not anymore. And we'll just read through this, and then we'll open it up for you all to share. So we started out this series talking about how Acts is really all about Jesus. The title of Acts is Acts of the Apostles, but really a better title could be Acts of Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Because what you find is the ministry of Jesus continues on in the book of Acts through the Holy Spirit. The apostles are doing all the same exact things Jesus did in Luke. They're just continuing on that ministry in the book of Acts. There are two temptations we looked at in Acts chapter 1 while we wait for Jesus to return. One of those temptations is that we will narrow the borders of God's reign, meaning that we will draw the circle of who's included too small, and we won't include everyone that the Spirit wants in the family of God. Another temptation for us is religious escapism. You know, when Jesus ascended into heaven, they looked up and Jesus went up into the clouds and they just stayed looking up at the clouds, like wondering, where did Jesus go? And the Spirit tells them, hey, you need to get to Jerusalem because God is doing something. Get back to work. Don't just look up to heaven. Stay rooted here on earth until Jesus returns. Pentecost, big event. It was a joining. It was a bringing diverse people together as one. So much happened on Pentecost, but one of the main things was that all these people who spoke all these languages were able to hear the gospel in their native tongue. The Spirit brought them together. After Pentecost, the believers devoted themselves to four things, and we asked, like, are we devoted to these things? To the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to prayer. We moved on and we see that immediately they start getting into a lot of trouble. Following the Spirit led to a lot of trouble for the believers. And we looked at the believers were among the people, and those in power didn't really like that they were among the people. They were a threat to the powerful, and instead of praying for deliverance, the disciples prayed for boldness. They prayed that they could continue their work in spite of the danger and threat. The story of Ananias and Sapphira is a really kind of complicated and difficult story, but Christina pointed out that it really highlights the importance of honesty in our faith communities. And I imagine many of you all were challenged by that sermon. New problems in the church demanded new leadership. There was a story of the Hellenistic widows being neglected. So the Jewish widows were getting the food that they needed, but the Hellenistic widows who were Greek were not getting the food they needed. And this was a big problem. And so they appointed seven leaders who were among that community, Hellenistic leaders, to help oversee the daily food distribution. Stephen was one of those seven. And Stephen was the first Christian martyr. And the thing that stuck out to me in this story was that Peter was killed not by the people you would label as the awful sinners. He was killed by faithful people, religious people. And we found that part of the reason was because they were afraid. We often harm others when we're afraid. And instead of letting fear guide us, how can we move towards faith, letting go and trusting God? In dramatic fashion, after that story, the Spirit led Philip to this Ethiopian eunuch who was a person of complexity and difference and brought this eunuch into the family of God. It's a really radical and challenging story. After that, Saul experiences his conversion. And Saul, we talked about how Saul was also a very religious person, very faithful to what he believed God was calling him to do. We talked about how he worshiped this kind of abstract Lord, but he needed to meet Jesus. He needed to meet the concrete Jesus because Jesus showed him what God was really all about. Peter needed to go through his own conversion. Peter was also a very obedient religious person, but his obedience needed to take flight into a new territory as he followed Jesus into a home of a Gentile, Cornelius. And he saw the Gentiles receive the Holy Spirit, and he's like, I can't stand in their way anymore because the Spirit's working here. Then we keep moving on. Some men from Cyprus and Cyrene, at that point, they were only mainly reaching out to Jewish people, but they decided we need to do something different. And so they broke rank, they crossed boundaries, and they started this really radical creative community in Antioch where they were reaching out to Gentiles, even though they weren't really given permission to do that yet. We never also lose sight of the prison in Acts. This is something that really hit some of you all pretty hard, and some of y'all told me you even started reading the books that I recommended about incarceration. But the disciples are arrested 11 times in the book of Acts. And the Spirit often sets them free. And there's a lot of powerful things there in those stories. Paul and Barnabas were partners for a little while. And they embark on their first missionary journey. And Christina talked about this, that it reveals three truths about our own journey of discipleship. First, following Jesus is a lifestyle of partnership with the Spirit. We must embrace our own and other people's full humanity. And we need to walk together. At the Jerusalem Council, that was when Dustin and Logan came up here and preached, and they said a lot more, but really the main gist here is that the Spirit created unity among these Christians who had very different views and experiences. You think it's hard to get people together today in unity. They had some incredibly hard issues they had to come to terms with, and they compromised. They found common ground, and they were able to move forward together. We talked also about Lydia, this woman who used her position and resources to support the early church. She even opened her home to Paul and Silas in spite of great risk. And then finally, last week, we talked about Paul in Athens. And he came into the city full of idolatry, probably disgusted and by all the rampant sin he saw around him. Yet instead of turning away from these people, the Spirit led Paul to turn towards them. And he reached out in love and found common ground with these folks. So that's where we've come from, right? And so hopefully this is jogging some stuff in your mind. And so now what we're going to do is, Dustin, if you want to come on up, I'm going to give him a microphone. Some instructions before we share. Keep it brief, okay? We don't need to give long, long speeches because that means not everybody will get to talk. Be kind and respectful in what you say as well. If you have to preface it, I don't want to offend anybody, then probably shouldn't say it, because it probably will offend somebody. Also, when you have a microphone, hold it close to your mouth, okay? You don't need to, like, kiss it, but hold it close to your mouth. Don't hold it down here. You see, you can't hear me too well. You can hear me well here, all right?
Not here.
Here, all right? And we will do our best to keep it up, keep it close to your mouth so we can hear you. So I just want to open it up for anyone to share any insights or thoughts that you've had over this series of Acts. This always impacts me when I can hear from you all. So the floor is open. Who's going to be the brave one to go first? Benjamin, not surprised. Not surprised. Benjamin's always got something to say.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Giving thanks to God. Giving honor to God this morning. Yeah, the book of Acts is one of my favorite books because I spent many times in prison and jails, but it wasn't for preaching the gospel. It wasn't for preaching. But my favorite scripture in the Bible in the book of Acts is when John when Peter and John was going to the temple to pray. Y'all remember that? When they was going to the temple to pray, and there was a guy there begging for money, and they said, silver, gold have we none, but such as we have, we give to thee. You know, I want what they had, you know, the Holy Spirit, because as I wandered the streets working with the homeless people, people always begging for money. You know, I can give you some money. Back when I was a sinner, I'd give you some drugs or some alcohol, but I can't give you no money, let me pray for you, you know. And that's my favorite one, because we got to understand that when God changes our lives, you know, it's not just for us, it's for those who are around us. And on that day to the temple, man, they had something that was so powerful that guy went into church and he was leaping and jumping and praising God. Can you imagine somebody coming here leaping and jumping and praising God because someone told them what they had in Jesus? God bless you.
Amen. Thank you for that. What else? Felice.
Okay, so my name is Felice, and I'm currently in grad school, so I think my brain just thinks about this like an assignment a little bit, but I just wanted to say the thing that really stood out to me was that the Ethiopian eunuch and Lydia and the folks in Cyprus and Cyrene were individuals who acted with boldness, and their individual choices supported the collective well-being. And I think it just really stood out to me because at this point in our society, it can be sometimes a little overwhelming to look at the collective choices that certain parties are making in the governmental system or certain groups of people, certain denominations are making. And it can feel like, oh my gosh, like these big groups are just so unified in their ideas. But I still believe that God uses individuals. And you never know when you're going to be the person that is the pivot point for a group. So they really stood out to me. Those stories were powerful. So the dream that God's placed on my heart is just the boldness of believers. Like the believers ask for boldness, not just for relief. And I would ask that we would be bold. And then also the artistry, creativity, and leadership of Lydia stood out to me because I don't think she was like the typical representative of who you would imagine would be a spiritual leader. But God uses all sorts of different gifts and talents. And so if you see yourself as maybe being out of the ordinary wheelhouse of who might make a difference for God, I think that you might be the individual that God wants to use. So the last thing was this idea from Acts 13 and 14 that breaking new ground requires partnerships with Jesus, Spirit, and each other. And I think that that's something that we have here at Embrace that I'm really grateful for. So in a world that wants to buy into narrow borders and religious escapism, I think we need to keep trying to do that work of standing up for unity and openness of thought without uniformity. I think that we can have unity without uniformity. And I see that. I see God doing that here with us. So.
Yeah, thank you, Felice. So lots of beautiful insights. Jackie.
My name is Jackie, and as usual, Felice's words have my brain spinning. And just the fact that the groups you pulled out, the Ethiopian eunuch, Lydia, the people of Cyrene, these are the marginalized people. These are the people who have no power in this society, and yet God gives them, the Spirit gives them the strength to reach out to Jesus, and the Spirit reaches back. And so thinking about myself as somebody who has so much privilege, how can I listen to the Spirit and do that? And thinking about the larger global church and this vision of true equality and reaching out to the Ethiopian eunuch who is sexually different, to Lydia who's a woman, this vision is really powerful. And so that's my dream for our church and for the larger church too.
Yeah, thank you, Jackie. The Spirit seemed very, very committed to bringing every last person into the family of God, and particularly those who have been excluded and left out. Yeah, Megan in the back.
Thank you. I'm Megan. I was making notes just of like which things had stood out to me. And number 12, when we're dealing with, again, we've already talked quite a bit about Antioch and the reaching out and doing things even when they weren't given permission to do so, looking to what God was doing rather than the boxes that God was put into. And so the things that have kind of been in my heart during this Acts season in my own journey has been reaching from the past to the future without letting go of either. And just that it can be so easy to be like, well, I'm going towards a thing and I forget my past. Or I'm still so holding on to the past that I'm walking backwards and I'm not seeing the future and seeing the people in front of us. And the dreams that God has placed on my heart are the idea of bridging the hurting and those who were once Saul or Christendom. And so the lingering questions or wonderings I have is, what does a church that actually embraces the hurting and the people on the fringes look like? Can we undo the cruelty and hate that the world has endured through Christendom? And then the final thing that has shimmered or stayed with me is Barnabas, that his body was on the line. His body was an outreach. And later, as we will get into, Barnabas throws down with John Mark when Paul is done with him. He has no interest. He does not believe. And yet, Barnabas' belief in the broken is redeemed, and Mark becomes the first of the Gospels to be written. And I don't know, that's just stuck with me.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. It's beautiful. Yeah, there's this, I've mentioned this before, but this African concept called Sankofa, where the image is a bird with the feet planted forward, but looking back, you know, and it's like taking those things from the past that are helpful, you know, as we walk into the future. But it's got to be both, right? And that idea, too, of obedience taking flight. You know, we are obedient to our tradition, our faith tradition, and what we come from, but we also need to allow the Spirit to take that obedience in new directions if the Spirit is leading. Yeah, it's beautiful. Yeah, John? Dustin, you got it. I could share my mic, too, but, you know, I kind of like mine. So. Just kidding.
Hey, good morning. I'm John. When you think about Paul not turning away from the idolaters, but going right to them, it just brings to mind something that has all of my lifetime been the struggle of the church, and that is this, especially with what you would consider the white, predominantly white churches, is this white savior mindset of, I have to be the one to go into this place or that place and tell them all the things I have to tell them. The problem with that is it becomes about us and not about God, and we almost like we're telling God, you can't reach them, we have to go reach them. And they use scripture to back up that. But I think about Native American people and how their relationship with God is deeper than many people that we interact with that are Christians. And you think about how when American Christians do go to a very remote village, tribe, and when they start talking to them about Jesus, the people there say, oh, yeah, we already know. We already know that. But they don't have a Bible. Just the Spirit has already been there. So then there are the cases that, like with Paul, and he goes and he finds all these idols, and they already knew there was something missing. I saw that, just that scene is so beautiful, how Paul is not freaked out by all the idols or whatever. He's like, oh, hey, I know this one. And so, like, when we start working with people, especially that are different than us, we can't go in there with the mindset of, I've got all the answers because I'm from this place of privilege. But we go in, we should go in there humbled that God has already been speaking to them, no matter what religion or faith they profess at the time. And we look for that idol that Paul saw, like, oh, there it is. Let me tell you about this one, because this one will make a full picture and a full connection in your life. So it's just important, as embracers, which we're already doing this, as we move forward and affect the world for Jesus, that we just continue to know that God is already there. Wherever there is, God is already there. God is already with them, whoever they are. We're just here to connect the pieces for them because God's already been speaking, and they just might need one more interaction to get the full picture.
Yeah, thank you, John. That's beautiful. There's a Wesleyan idea called prevenient grace, and it's this idea that it's the grace that becomes before we even know we need it, that God's Spirit is working in us, pursuing us all our whole life from the moment we're born. Yeah, so God is working in everybody's lives in some way. Thank you for sharing that. What other thoughts y'all have? Taja in the back, and then we'll do Lisa after that. Thank you, Dustin. Dustin's getting a workout this morning. That's good. Did you go for a run this morning, or? Okay, so you're getting a second one in. That's good. Getting that step count up. I do want to
Hi, my name's Taja. Going through the Acts, I've been feeling really inspired by the sense of responsibility and accountability that we have as Christians to our community. But truly, listening to a lot of the messages, John, that you've been speaking to us, it feels like it's meant, a lot of it feels like it's going to have a bigger impact on someone who has more privilege than me, like their newer ideas to someone, maybe white, someone who has more power than me. So a lot of time I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, I do support and appreciate this message, but it's like, what am I to get from this? So I have thought that, but having those thoughts doesn't really lead me to learning or growing in any way. So I've been wanting to think creatively, like, how can I, as a person who is a minority, like, how am I called to be close with someone deeply different than me? My first thought was someone outside of my culture group. So there's that. But then I wanted to think, okay, maybe somebody in my family who is another woman of color. So I'm seeing ways that we are still deeply different, and the amount of privilege that I have as someone in this generation, in this world, and the way that things have changed versus even in my mom's life or my grandmother's life, and how hard they have worked for me to exist in this place now. So I'm kind of seeing my responsibility in teaching them this level of vulnerability and freedom that they never were allowed to have, that I can freely embrace. So that's what I've been coming into with this.
No, thank you. That's really beautiful, and thank you for your honesty and vulnerability around that and your experience hearing these messages. Yeah, that's really helpful. Lisa, I think, had.
My name is Lisa, as John said. I'm one of the people who, I take a picture of the screen whenever there's something up there that I want to keep reminiscing on. And I truly can't tell you which sermon this is from. It's from March, if that's helpful. But there was a quote that you put on the screen by Soren Kierkegaard that encompasses a lot of what I've thought about through this whole series. So I'm just going to read that because I can't say things better than Kierkegaard can. It is well known that Christ consistently used the expression follower. He never asks for admirers, worshipers, or adherents. No, he calls disciples. It is not adherents of a teaching, but followers of a life Christ is looking for. Jesus came to be the pattern, to leave footprints for the person who would join him, who would become a follower. The admirer never makes any true sacrifices. He always plays it safe. Though in words, phrases, songs, he is inexhaustible about how highly he prizes Christ, he renounces nothing. He will not reconstruct his life and will not let his life express what he is supposedly admiring. Not so for the follower. No, no, the follower aspires with all his strength to be what he admires. And I think that's what the disciples are doing the whole time in Acts. And that has been really challenging for me as somebody who did grow up in the church, to be like, am I just doing the things and singing the songs and saying that I believe it, but not actually doing anything about it? So.
Yeah, thank you, Lisa. That's beautiful. And very challenging. Those words always challenge me, you know. And I talked about, I think back then, that like if you read Acts, Luke and Acts are written by the same person. And you read Luke and you see all the things that Jesus was doing in Luke, and then you read Acts and you're like, these apostles are doing all the exact same things Jesus was doing in Luke. And it's just such a beautiful representation that they're literally carrying on the ministry of Jesus through following in his footsteps and walking with him. And so, yeah. Dan.
The thing that's jumped out at me through all of this continues to be the formation of the community of around Christ, built around Jesus and his teachings. And I think it's important for us to remember that Jesus, not Jesus, but the disciples and the apostles and the other believers didn't just go out and start preaching at people. Well, okay, Peter did on Pentecost, but they also built community, and the community exemplified the words and made it irresistible. And I think that that's something that we need to keep in mind, is that it is our presence with others, both in the church, in this church, and outside this church, that's going to attract people to Jesus and into his community.
Thank you, Dan. Yeah, there's almost nothing that happens in Acts outside of community and groups of people. Yeah. So like Felice said, the individual can step up and play an impact, but it always leads to community. It leads to more solidarity with other people. Yeah. Anybody else? We probably have time for one or two more. Yeah, Zadie.
A couple of themes throughout Acts that have spoken to me is community and diversity. And those are things that are near and dear to my heart. And what I'm learning is that community doesn't mean like people that are close to around me. It's a community of believers in Jesus. And I've traveled to Kenya and to Uganda, and there are people there that are in my community of believers. It's everywhere. And the diversity is something that really is on my heart these days, because I want all people included in Jesus' love, and I want all people to know that Jesus loves them just the same as he loves anybody else. So it's the marginalized people. And it seems in our society that we're trying to maybe get away from that. We want the same people together, somebody who looks like me and not a diverse group. And one of the things that you asked us a question some time ago is, when did I have a conversation with someone different than me? And I think that's what Acts is teaching us, that we need to be meeting other people that are not just like me, but that love Jesus.
Yeah, thank you, Zadie, for that. It's really strikes much of the heart of what Acts is all about. See, I want to just revisit something Felice was sharing, that an, you know, the Spirit is working in individuals, and those individuals end up following the Spirit but making a deep impact on their communities. And I just think, like, the Spirit is working, hopefully, in each of your all's lives in some way. And my hope is that as we go through our life together, as the Spirit is convicting you and challenging you and giving you dreams, that you wouldn't just hold on to that just for yourself, but that you would share that with the community. And that if you have an idea about something, you're like, we need to do better at this, or we need to move forward in this way, like, then run with it and talk to us. Let's come together and try to work together to help this church continue to follow the Spirit into the future. Because we are living in really tough times right now. People are facing a lot of suffering and a lot of pain. Our nation's future seems very uncertain right now. There's so much going on. There's war happening. And we need our church more than ever. And we need one another. And so the church is the people. It's you all. It's not me. It's not Rachel. It's not Christy. It's not the staff here. The church is you all and all of us together. And so as the Spirit is working in your heart, maybe like we talked about before with Esther, maybe God is raising you up for such a time as this, you know, to bring the community in to whatever God, the dreams God's placing on your heart. And so
I encourage you all to continue to listen to the Spirit and also allow the Spirit to speak to you on how you might help to enrich the life of our church here at Embrace. And we want to be the type of church where the Spirit can kind of bubble up in all different ways throughout our community so that we can continue to be the church that Jesus wants us to be. And so I thank you all. Thanks, Dustin, for passing the mic around. Super helpful. And we're going to move into our time of communion. And, you know, if there's things that God's doing in your heart and you don't like talking in front of a whole group and you want to talk to someone, I'd love to talk to you about it. And so let me know. Set up a time to get together, have coffee, whatever. I'd love to talk with you all more about what God might be doing in your heart. We're going to share communion as we end our time together. And the Spirit, you know, Acts is much about a joining. It's about bringing together all different types of people in unity in the Holy Spirit. And the Lord's Supper does that for us. All of us come together, all of us very different, unique people who are created to be exactly who you are, yet we come together in unity because we all need Jesus in our lives. And Jesus has this unifying way about him, bringing us together because Jesus loves each and every one of us so, so much and wants every single last person on this planet to be part of his family. Let's bow our heads. God, thank you so much for being with us this morning. I thank you for the energy, the creative and thoughtful and insightful energy that we felt here in this space. I thank you for even those who didn't say anything out loud this morning. I know that hopefully things are stirring in their hearts as they reflect on maybe how you're teaching them and guiding them over these past few months here at our church. God, thank you for this bread and juice. We pray it would be for us the body and blood of Christ, that you would fill us up today in a fresh way, and that we would leave here different than when we came in, that we would leave here looking more and more and more like Jesus. Lord, thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us, even when we don't deserve it. And thank you for walking with us through this life. Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for loving us, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite those who are helping me serve communion to come on up to the front. Here at Embrace, we take communion by you'll form two lines down the center aisle. As you come forward, have your hands open to receive the bread and juice. The server will tear off a piece of bread for you. They'll dip it in the cup for you, and then they'll place it in your hand. If you would like a gluten-free option, we do have that. Just let your server know, and they will hand it to you. If you prefer to take communion on your own in the back, we do have prepackaged elements in the back of the room as well. Everybody's invited to take communion. You don't have to be part of our church. You don't have to have it all figured out. Everybody's welcome to come. Just give me a moment to prepare it, and then I'll invite you up. So you all are invited to come whenever you feel led.
Feet on the grass, I'm listening. I see you now in everything. The fire, the stars, the blazing sun all say it's true. When I see the light, I am seeing you. And when I see the light, I'm seeing you. A still small voice, your frequency resonates in the deepest part of me. The wind, the storm, the morning dove, all say it's true. When I hear their song, I am hearing you. And when I hear their song, I am hearing you. And everything, in everything I see you. In everything, in everything I see you. A hand in mine, I'm not alone. It's all right to need someone. A kindred heart, a mother's arms, all say it's true. When I'm holding on, I'm holding on to you. And when I'm holding on, I'm holding on to you. In everything, in everything I see you. In everything, in everything I see you. A broken jar, a fragrant room, she spends it all to honor you. There's nothing wasted, nothing more that I can do. When I give it all, I am loving you. When I give it all, I am loving you. In everything, in everything, in everything I see you. 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 Right by my side,
oh, right by my side.
Oh, right by my side.
Everything I ever wanted, I have found in you.
Oh, right by my side.
Everything I ever wanted, I have found in you.
Oh, right by my side.
Everything I ever wanted, I have found in you.
And I need you. And I need you. Every step of the way, and I need you, and I need you, every step of the way.
Amen. Amen. Well, as you're able, let's all stand together for the benediction. One reason we stand together in church is because it is a sign and an image that we stand together in our day-to-day lives. And so Reverend Barber once said that we stand together because we stand together, and I love that. And in many ways, that is what Acts is also about, that we stand together and we walk together step by step on this journey, along with the Spirit of God coming alongside us and moving in us and through us. And so may the love of God the Father,
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen. Go in God's peace. We'll see you next time.